Curiosity is kind of the core of what put me into science. It's the idea that you could discover new things, and especially discover new things about animals. The red-cockaded woodpecker is not impressive physically. What is special about them is their ecology and their social system.
Jeff Walters has spent decades studying red-cockaded woodpeckers, which everyone just calls RCWs. I wanted to work with Jeff as my advisor because of the quality of his research. We all learn to listen very carefully and like really value the few words that he would very carefully communicate to us.
In 1981, two colleagues, Phil Doerr, who was a faculty member in my department at NC State, and his then graduate student, Jay Carter, had started a project on red-cockaded woodpeckers. There was not a single increasing population of red-cockaded woodpeckers. Everybody thought they were headed for extinction. And the deal was, Jay and Phil were handling the endangered species conservation kind of part of it, and I would study the social system. The red-cockaded woodpecker is unique in being the only woodpecker species in the world that nests exclusively in live pine trees. There's a good reason that most woodpeckers do not make cavities in living pine trees. It's really hard to do. Most woodpeckers can carve out a cavity in a dead tree or dead wood in a matter of days to weeks. Red-cockaded woodpecker, we're talking about years to make a cavity. When I started working on them, the average here in the Sandhills was 13 years. My idea was, well, maybe if we put cavities out there, we could increase numbers. I naively thought, like, people, like, will really like this idea. But to my surprise, when I pitched that idea to them, I was told that's probably the dumbest idea that we've heard in our careers, that you would make cavities for a woodpecker. I went back to NSF, wrote a proposal, got funding for another 3 years from them. Here in the Sandhills, where we are today, we set up 20 sites. So up on a ladder with a power drill, what could go wrong, right? That was the idea. And we put these in, and then we had 20 controls, and we got 19 out of 20 new groups. Occupied 0 for 20 in the controls. And at the time, that was the largest increase ever recorded in a red-cockaded woodpecker population. And this was over a 2-year period. So we went from no populations growing anywhere to showing that this might actually work. A lot of people were still very skeptical that this would work on any kind of large scale, but there were two places that were interested in seeing if it would work. Marine Corps Base Camp Lejeune in coastal North Carolina and Eglin Air Force Base in the Panhandle of Florida were really interested in us coming in there and doing that. The issue with military training and RCW recovery was that because so little was known or understood about why the red-cockaded woodpecker continued to decline, there were a lot of rules in place about what you could and couldn't do near them. They really wanted to recover the species. They wanted to get on the right side of that equation, so we just started off doing it, and to their credit, they were like fully committed to it from the beginning and have never changed. Still, to this day, committed to it. If we look at what has happened under the new management paradigm, first at Camp Lejeune, started out with 26 family groups. We have over 140 now. At Eglin Air Force Base, we had a little over 200, have over 500 now. And that population's been declared recovered. More than 70% of the populations of red-cockaded woodpeckers increased.
I would definitely say like that study he did and his understanding of RCWs was what shaped that recovery plan and made it so effective.
If you make me talk about this too much, I'll start crying. I never imagined, you know, when I started out that again, it was just curiosity at first. I love studying animals. I never imagined that I would do something that had an impact.
Penguin poop always gets a bit of a laugh.
When penguins get together, they poop all over the pebbles. We call them guano stains, please.
Oh, so what is guano?
Poop. Poop. You can see the areas where the penguins have been breeding because it's just covered with poop, and that poop is red, and it's really distinctive from the rock surface that's around it.
We're not relying on seeing individual penguins, but we're relying on seeing this guano stain that they leave on the landscape.
When I was a grad student at Michigan, I was studying vegetation from space. And one of the advisors on my dissertation committee, he, at one point or another, he asked me the question about whether you could see penguins from space. And it seemed like satellite remote sensing would be the ticket. I published a paper on the measurements that I made saying that, yeah, this could be feasible. This is a CCT, a computer-compatible tape. So this was the technology in the 1980s. If you wanted to actually collect the data to do a full continent search for daily penguin colonies, we need a stack of tapes about the size of a tall tree. And then, of course, each tape cost $3,000 if you needed 200 or so, and that would be $600,000 worth of tape. And of course, everybody loves penguins, but nobody loves penguins that much. The technology just wasn't there. It was impossible. I put this on ice until 2008.
I don't want to do science in a vacuum. I want to do science that is sensitive to the ongoing debates that matter to the environment. That's very much been the driving force of my own work in Antarctica. Now, this is the traditional way that we count penguins. We actually go to Antarctica and we count them one by one. But this is incredibly labor intensive, and it's just not possible to survey all of the penguin colonies in Antarctica that we need. So I started digging through the literature, and I found these old papers from a researcher named Matt Schwaller. Now, these papers were from the mid-1980s. I just sort of assumed that Matt had maybe retired or had just completely stopped thinking about penguins.
Yeah, well, I was not living under a rock, but I was busy with the other aspects of my career. After 2008, I could just pick up as much data as I wanted for free on a fairly high-speed internet connection. So all of a sudden, boom, I had, you know, unlimited data.
So I remember distinctly that first phone call that I had with Matt that was like, you know, talking to one of your idols, because his initial work had been so critical to my thinking about how we might use satellite imagery. And so we've been working together ever since, I think almost 14 years now. We wrote this proposal to NASA to expand our work and to build a decision support tool that would make sure that policymakers were getting as close to real-time information on penguin populations as possible. When this grant was ultimately funded, we had the opportunity to bring on a postdoc to work on that project, and Chris was the perfect person to take that role because of his background in statistical modeling and computer programming.
What I really like is trying to have a model of why something is happening biologically and to formulate that model using statistical language or statistical models. That guano stain or poop stain on the ground is proportional roughly to the number of birds that are breeding at that site in a year. If we can say something about how the populations of these birds are changing over time, we can potentially say something about something larger about like what's going on in marine ecosystems.
And so the goal was to create a browser-based tool that anybody on the internet could go to, and they could immediately find the best available information on how many penguins there are in Antarctica, how their populations have changed over time,
and what we might expect for the future. We completed, I think, the first version of this tool in around 2016, 2017, and it's been in regular use by policymakers since then. So one of the big decisions that policymakers need to make is to design what are called marine protected areas. It was clear that there were some enormous penguin colonies in this chain of islands called the Danger Islands.
There were just, I think, 200 or so pixels on that one island. It turned out to be a really big colony.
And in response, the marine protected area for the Western Antarctic Peninsula was expanded by something like 2 million hectares to include the Danger Islands. The Danger Islands was such a nice example of how when we discover things, we can make sure that the best science is actually driving the conservation and management decisions.
It's really been just a thrill and an honor, and just personally rewarding to work with Chris and with Heather.
So it feels pretty good as a scientist to know that the work I'm doing could have these impacts.
We're just sort of at the beginning of what it means to do ecology from space. There is a very active community of ecologists that are now using satellite imagery to track everything from, you know, elephants to, you know, walruses. Matt was way ahead of his time, you know, thinking of this in the mid-1980s, but I think the computation and the computing power and the availability of imagery has really caught up with this, you know, kind of quirky idea that we might be able to see penguins from space and actually use that for conservation.
This approach to AI has been used in products in ways that people don't realize.
When you do a Google search, when you want to find a photo on your phone,
we can talk to our cell phones and they will respond to us as though they understood what we actually said.
That's all done by neural networks. In future, much more is going to be done by neural networks.
Those services that you're aware of and the way they operate today wouldn't be the way they are were not for this technology. My dad absolutely never set out to, you know, build a company or build a technology or build something like that. My dad set out to understand how people think and learn. And eventually he figured out that this neural, what we now call neural network approach, was a real superior way to sort of model and then understand and explore human thinking and learning.
I use neural networks because I'm interested in how our minds work. So Dave Rommelhart and I started working together in the late 70s.
In the late 1970s, almost everybody in conventional AI thought that using neural networks was just nonsense. David Rommelhart's major contribution was that he rediscovered and pioneered the use of the backpropagation algorithm, which is a very effective way to learn complicated neural networks, and is actually the way all these current large language models are learned.
A neural network is like a network of people who are all friends sending messages to each other, except they send very simple messages. They either get more excited or calm down a little bit. If there are neurons in your brain that do these jobs, it must be there must be some learning process that tells our neurons how to wire themselves up to build that neural network.
In your brain, you have a lot of neurons. They have connection strengths between them. And when you learn, you change the strengths of those connections. And the backpropagation algorithm is a way of deciding whether, if you increase the strength of a connection, it'll make the neural network work better or worse at the task you just gave it. So let's take an example of you have a neural network and you'd like it to say yes if there's a bird in the image and no if there's no bird in the image. But what you really want to do is show it an image of a bird and then ask the question, how do I change the strength of the connections so the feature detectors are better at detecting birds? That's what backpropagation does. It sends information backwards through the network to figure out how to change all the connection strengths to make it better at giving the right answer.
Basically, the purpose we had for forming that group was to demonstrate the usefulness of these neural network kinds of models. In the end, it turned out to be a two-volume pair of books called Parallel Distributed Processing. The breakthroughs that we had in the 1980s were very exciting to people for several years. And there was this wave of interest in neural networks that carried into the late 90s. Then it began to fade. The learning algorithm that Dave and Jeff had introduced seemed like it wasn't powerful enough, or it was so slow that it could never solve the problem.
In computer science, people lost interest in neural networks because they discovered other methods that worked about as well on small data sets. And at that point, nobody had any really big data sets.
The thing is that the computers started to get faster.
So work done by my students in 2012 was what really broke the dam. That's when huge numbers of computer scientists suddenly started believing, hey, these neural networks really work. They managed to use NVIDIA GPU boards to recognize 1,000 different kinds of objects using a database developed by Fei-Fei Li that was big enough so that neural networks really worked much better than any other technique.
It produced a very big improvement in one step compared to the state of the art before that, and suddenly it got everybody's attention around these ideas again. My hope and expectation is that we will come to see neural network-based artificial intelligence systems as resources that sort of leverage our own human capabilities.
I absolutely think about my dad when we think about AI today. There's a direct line from the work that he did to some of the most advanced AI technologies now.
If you look at any of the really big breakthroughs, they come from basic scientific curiosity. But once the basic science had been done, that has clearly led to an industry which now people think of as a trillion-dollar industry.
And it's certainly a lesson I've learned in life, that basic research is invaluable.
I think federal funding of basic science improves our understanding of nature and improves our understanding of the natural world, and that's intrinsically valuable in its own right.
You never know where it's going to go. It's where discoveries happen. New areas of knowledge are opened up. And then those can have applications.
So curiosity is what drives scientists. And they do their best work when they're trying to solve puzzles that they're really curious about. That's the goose that lays the golden eggs. Thank you.